I need to use this, don't I, for whatever we're doing with this?
Yes.
Oh, it is on. I want everybody to know that this is totally unrehearsed, as hard as that might be to believe. You capturing all this? That's just wonderful. I'm Steve Jones. I'm the president of Antioch University New England. And as I learned yesterday, and made clear, folks understood it at many venues, I am the ninth president of Antioch University New England. And I'm trying to subdue the pride in telling you that I am going to be the last single-digit president that this university will ever have. It's humbling, it really is. I want to welcome all of you to our 50th anniversary celebration. What a thrill. Yesterday was an incredible day. And 50 years ago, Antioch extended and created an outstation, the first outstation, this one in Putney, Vermont. And several people described it as a beachhead, the outstation in the woods of Vermont. We remain an outstation, still home-based in Ohio, and we've crossed the river, as you know. We migrated down from Harrisville, and we're now here along the banks of the Ashwaubee. And because we're still based in Ohio, we remain under the leadership, the incredible leadership of our chancellor, who is located in Ohio. And our chancellor is Felice Noodleman. She's here with us. Oh, come on, I can't introduce her. Yeah. I want to be the ninth president for a while longer. That's wonderful. And as I look to my left, as I read the bios, We're blessed to have our panelists here today to address a compelling topic. I am going to sit there just spellbound listening to some of the stories. And I, from what I've heard informally, I hope the stories are, I hope they venture into some of that stuff I've heard. Otherwise, it could be dull. But with these folks, it's not going to be dull. I've been to Glen Maples. I've bowed at the iconic white birch. I've felt along its branches. It's one of the deepest symbols I've ever seen of something as novel, creative, innovative, and daring as Antioch University, New England. I've walked the grounds. I have a keen sense and appreciation for the physical space, as well as, I believe, the spiritual space that I believe we'll hear about. I made myself a note to hold, I'm holding now Heidi's book. I've read it, I've spent time with Heidi talking about it. Oh yeah, thank you, my prompter here. Good time talking with Heidi and many others from those days. And I've been blessed to share a few meals with Claire Wilson. What an incredible lady. She's not in the room, I don't see her.
Today.
Later today, okay. And I visited with Pat Wan last month with Roy Fairfield at his home in Connecticut, the founding director of the Outpost in Vermont. And what a delight. He's 96 years old. He wanted to be with us today. He's reached a point where he doesn't travel well. And we presented to Roy one of Ty Minton's bells. And Ty commented when he selected this bell for us to give to him. He said this should apply very well to Roy pardon me, and his history with Antioch. It was a lizard. And he said the lizard symbolizes a master of dealing with change. It symbolizes ability and skill in harmonizing with a new environment. And it struck me that Antioch University New England, that we are the lizard. The lizard doesn't make a real good mascot though, so just kind of keep that in this room. And Roy's book, I'm gonna cheat, I've gotta go over and get it. Roy wrote a kind of an autobiographical sketch of his recollections as being the founding director. And the name of it, The Early Days. Anybody know how to spell days? You guessed it. The Early Days at Antioch-Putney Graduate School. An autobiographical perspective. And he says in it, I perceived it as a beachhead, an operation with more enthusiasm and courage than money. It's interesting, isn't it, that some things change very, very, very slowly. And I assure you that we are still rich in enthusiasm and courage. To the panelists, thank you so much for your gift of being here and sharing your reflections. I am really eager to hear. And now I'm going to turn this over to an Antioch Putney alumna who is also on our Antioch University New England Board of Trustees, Pat Wan.
Informative introduction, and I am delighted to join Steve in welcoming all of you to this panel on activism and social justice and the role that Antioch New England has played in history. And in order to proceed with that, I think we should set a little bit of the context, a little bit more. Very specifically, Putney Graduate School had been founded in 1949 by Morris Mitchell. Actually, I think he said that he started the conversation and the planning at the end of the year. So some people date it to 1950 when Putney Graduate School began, with its unique focus on experiential education and respect for the individual journey of education. And it was in the early 60s when Morris Mitchell decided that he really wanted to partner with an undergraduate institution and approached Antioch College and James Dixon as its president to found that. And then as Steve mentioned, Roy Fairfield was the first director hired. Roy had been teaching government at Ohio University, and then decided to take on this new adventure. Before we go any more into that and hear from our panelists, I would just like to get a reading from you, the audience, as to when you became affiliated in some way as student, faculty, or staff with Antioch University New England. So how many of you have come in the last 15 years, let's say since the millennium? How many of you? Some hands, good. Great, thank you for your interest in your history. How many of you came in the 90s? Okay. How about in the 80s? And the 70s? Good, okay, we have some representation from each decade. Now let's get a little more granular with the 60s. How many came from either 68 or 69? Okay, how about 66 or 67? All right, we see more hands. And 64 or 65? All right, so we have some representative from back. And then we have Todd, from whom we'll hear in a few minutes, who came even earlier than that. So let's proceed with the panel.
They're also on from the 50s.
Thank you. All right, I should have listened. So again, we've got some deep roots present here. So the purpose of our panel is actually threefold. We wanted to learn about the pedagogical and sociological forces, or the social forces really, behind the founding of Antioch-Putney Graduate School. We want to learn about the Antioch-Putney students and faculty and their participation in civil rights and social activism of the times. And we also really wanted to share stories and record stories before they slip away, and so that we have a more complete history of our institution. And to that end, we are recording, we're doing a video recording of this event, and we'll be recording a number of the events through the weekend, and also providing opportunities for people to record their individual stories, and there'll be more about that later. The panelists have been chosen because they were early stakeholders and really game changers in the founding days of the institution. They each have a myriad of told and really untold stories, and they are going to be limited in their initial remarks to 10 minutes, which is going to leave them frustrated and us frustrated, but we've decided on this strict time limit so that we can have time for questions and also some stories from you after they speak. So I'll introduce all four panelists briefly now. There are bios available to you in the table outside if you'd like to pick up a bio description and learn more about their background. So today, now, in the interest of time, I'll just give a few basic facts about each one, and then after I introduce all of them, they'll speak in succession with one another. Starting with Todd Bayer. Todd joined Putney Graduate School in 1961, first as a student and then as a faculty, teaching with Morris Mitchell. Todd stayed on then to teach through the transition year, that first transition year of 1964 and 65. And he, before he joined Antioch, he had studied at Harper College. He earned his bachelor's degree from Binghamton and a master's at the University of British Columbia. Our second speaker, Fran Silvernail, was hired in the spring of 1964 to join the founding director, Roy Fairfield, and Todd Bayer as the initial faculty in the program. After the first year in Putney, Fran served as the coordinator and faculty at the Washington, D.C. Baltimore Center for two more years, 1965 to 1967. In that center, graduate students taught as interns in the inner city schools, and that was a model that was used also not just in Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, but also in Philadelphia. Fran earned his bachelor's, master's, and doctorate degrees at Michigan State University. Our third speaker, David Burry, attended Antioch-Putney from 1967 to 1969, and he had, before he came to Antioch, had been a Peace Corps volunteer in Chile from 1964 to 66. After teaching for several years on the secondary level, he moved into leadership positions in education and in arts management. David earned his bachelor's degree at Bethany College. Our final speaker in the series here is Heidi Watts. Heidi served as one of the three core faculty members from 1968 to 1972 with Robert Brinkhoff and then director Norman Wilson. After she earned her doctorate in 1984 from Cornell University, she came back to Antioch as chair of the education department.
Co-chair. It's very important not to leave David Sobel out of this story.
Co-chair. Thank you for that clarification. And then she went on after 1996, she became adjunct faculty with the Environmental Studies Department, where she continued to teach until 2011. And as was mentioned, she authored our book, Antioch in New England, the first 8 years. So with that, with those introductions, let me invite Todd to come and speak with us.
Well, Pat has pointed out, I'm the link with the past. And I'm going to break my remarks down into three sections, I think, in order to understand really the significance of Putney, you need some background, brief background information. Then I'm going to talk about Morris Mitchell. He was the second utopian socialist to arrive. There were probably others, but I can't retain all of them. And then finally, I'm going to talk about myself, how I was drawn to the Putney School from British Columbia. After a fruitless search in Lovejoy's catalog for an alternative in graduate education, the only thing I could find that was vaguely innovative and different from the standard teacher training programs, this is back in 61, was the Putney Graduate School. Anyway, I want to start talking about Putney and how there was a confluence of many socially significant events over the history of Putney, and I'm just going to briefly run through a few of them. One of the first visionary arrivals was John Humphrey Noyes, and you spell that N-O-Y-E-S. He was a utopian socialist, and he brought his band of what they called themselves the perfectionists to Putney. And he created a solvent, vibrant community, but it only lasted for a few years because one of his visions was what you would call today open marriage. There were no sexual restrictions for men or women. And while the community was initially insular, once some of the local daughters started to join the community, there was a strong reaction. So you could say he was probably the most socially disruptive, in my mind, to come to Putney. And they were driven out. And if you know something about your history of intentional communities, he went to Oneida, New York, and founded a much larger community there. He was also driven out of Oneida after a number of years and ended up in Ontario. So he's the first significant social force that I identify in Putney that I think shaped it right down to the day Now then, I have to leave ahead. The next one would be the Putney School, founded by Carmelita Hinton in 1935. She came from Cambridge, Mass, where she'd been doing homeschooling or schooling for a number of friends. And she was a vibrant, charismatic, also autocratic woman. When she ran the Putney School, there was no deviation from her instructions or her vision of how the school should be. And let me back up a little. So she mortgaged her house. She bought a large 600-acre farm on West Hill in Putney and started the school in 35. Initially, only friends of daughters came because they were worried about the sons getting into college at the time. But it became obvious very soon that there was no problem. So there was also a flow of young men after that. And part of her program was not just academics, but a very vigorous work program. The school included a large dairy. It had a woodlot. They maple sugared in the spring, and students were expected to participate in all of this, starting with farm chores at 6 a.m. on a rotating basis, so they all got this work experience. So she continued over the years until 49, when there was a rebellion of the faculty. Because of her autocratic ways, there were no particular salary schedules. People were paid according to what she thought they were worth. And in one case, she discovered one of the staff teachers was lecturing in class, and she fired him, of course, on the spot, because so much was based on reading and class discussion, and she didn't like the idea of having lecturers at least dominate in a class. I think another force would be the arrival or the development, somewhat disruptive, the Putney Co-op in 1940, which displaced or competed with another local store. And today, the Putney Co-op, if you happen to go there, is unusual because not all the there are many, many co-ops in Vermont. Nearly every small town, not every, but Burlington has the major store, Montpelier. And the Putney Co-op is thriving still today. And if you go by it on the way to West Hill and Glen Maples later today, you should stop in and see it. It's a wonderful example of a small town co-op, of course, locally owned by the people of Putney.
It also happens to be the longest continuous operating co-op in the United States.
Pardon?
It happens to be the longest continually
operating. Didn't I say that?
You didn't say that.
In Vermont, but not
in the United States.
Not in New Hampshire. The longest running co-op in New Hampshire is the Hanover Co-op, which goes back to 36. I only know that because I'm a member of the Hanover Co-op. Anyway.
I stand corrected.
I'm going to move on to, no, I should back up a bit. I'm getting ahead of myself. In 49-50, because half of the faculty resigned at the Putney School, Carmelita Hinton had the brilliant idea to create a graduate school to train teachers to teach in the so-called Putney way. Well, she founded the school. She had known Morris for many years. She identified him as the perfect director, and he came to Putney in 49 or 50 and became the director of the Putney School, and it was financed largely for the first, I'm not sure, 5 years or so by the Putney School. So now I'll turn to Morris, and how did he arrive? What was his background? Morris was came from an unusual Southern family. He was born in South Carolina, an illustrious family of Southern progressives, which you would be, probably they exist today, but they're less visible. I have to skip ahead because of time. He was a Quaker, completely eschewed titles. So even though his name was Morris Mitchell, everyone universally called him Morris, from kids on up. He worked in the early 30s for the Farm Security Administration, and during the early years of the recovery from the Depression, he founded, and this would be one of his singular early achievements, an intentional community, Macedonia, in Clarksville, Georgia. And that community included it didn't have any of the attributes of the John Humphrey Noyes. It was a very appropriately conventional place, especially for North Georgia. It included a dairy. They had a toy-making factory, and it was run pretty much on the basis of utopian socialist communities at the time. People who needed cash for, say, personal needs were given whatever they needed, and the assumption was that people wouldn't take more, a disproportionate amount. The community lasted until, well, it was riven in 1940 over the Second World War. Morris was a strong CEO, and when the war started, many in the community, it tore the community apart because many thought they should join the war effort, that it was worth fighting against the Nazis. So about half of them left, and the community, because of the war and the departure, struggled on until 1945, and then it was disbanded, although there are still remnants of it to be seen. Then Morris, he taught at New College, Columbia, briefly. A program influenced and created by John Dewey, probably in my mind, Vermont's most illustrious citizen. And he came to Putney in 1950, and he, of course, was a visionary in many ways, and also a charismatic speaker, and his vision was to create a largely, but not entirely, experientially based education on field trips, visitors who had something of importance to say come to the school, and many field trips. And I'm thinking what else I could tell you about Morris. But I'm going to move on to how I came to the Putney School. As I mentioned, I came from British Columbia in the effort to find an alternative program in graduate education. And I came really as a social product of a sterile suburban life. And my year as a student at Putney was truly transformative. And it was second only to one I had at the age of 13 when I was sent to work as an unruly teenager. I was sent to northern New York to work on a dairy farm, a hardscrabble dairy farm, over the summer. And having had a coddled suburban life, I struggled. And of course, wanted to go home, but my parents said, you stay there. And over the course of the summer, I learned about work. I not only learned skills, but I learned the pleasure of hard work, which has carried me to this day. And I think it's a very important aspect for everyone, all kids growing up. They need an opportunity for real work. Anyway, so I came from British Columbia. I was very socially naive, apolitical, really, and I'm just gonna briefly run through what the program was like for me. It was individually based, really. Everyone developed a year's program with a faculty member based on what their interests were at the time. And that, as I say, combined with many field trips around New England to various schools, to co-ops, anything that Morris happened to think was socially significant. And we carried on over the fall, mostly with seminars, individual reading, making presentations, evaluating each other's work. And then we planned, and these were mostly collective decisions. There were 15, and that was the full enrollment. And there was quite a diversity. There were always a few, I don't know where Morris found them, Haitians, Indians in the program. I never knew where they came from, but Morris would draw them in, and they were, of course, always scholarship students. And in the late fall, we planned to go to White Ponds. That was the home of Macedonia, and work for several weeks over Christmas. Morris abolished Christmas. There was no Christmas, that was just another day. And we were going to cut pulp. We were on our way to Mexico, where we were going to live and work on a heated patio, which is very similar to a caboose. We were going to go to some regional planning schemes and also do some anthropological work, excuse me, in Chiapas in southern Mexico. But we were first going to, our dream, our collective dream was to go to Cuba, but of course we didn't have the financing, and at the time you could go from Mexico City, short flight, to Havana. So we were going to work cutting pulpwood. But as it turned out, I was the only one who, in the group, everyone else had come from urban or suburban areas. No one else had had any work experience. They didn't know what a chainsaw was. So our work project didn't generate the income we needed to buy tickets to go to Cuba. It barely paid for our meager rations. So, well, that went through Christmas, and then we continued on. I think we had three vans at the time, something like VW buses. We went on to Mexico, to Pátzcuaro, where we pursued our personal interests and spent, we did intensive Spanish studies. Many of the students stayed with families. I actually had two small children at the time. And we did various field trips there down to the Rio Balsas on the west coast of Mexico, where there was a large regional system plan being developed, modeled after the Tennessee Valley Authority to provide electricity and irrigation to an impoverished area on the coast. And then later on in the spring approach, we went to, as I mentioned, Chiapas, and stayed with some anthropologists, as there were some very unusual minor tribes, Chimolos in Chiapas, still in relatively intact communities. Then we came back and we journeyed back to Putney for a summation of the year. And the summation, what's happening with my time? I'm up. I didn't say that song. Okay, well, just finally, we came back to graduation, and that consisted of a week of summarizing our experiences of the year in seminars. Morris had made a table as long from an old counter. Now, I've barely said anything about Morris's range of work skills. If you want to know, you'll have to ask me.
As we look at the history of Antioch University New England, which of course included Antioch-Putney and the Putney Graduate School, which Todd has so well described, I think one can simply say, just read Heidi's book. And she has done such an outstanding job of really covering the history of Antioch-Putney. And the only thing of it is, it stopped at the 25-year mark, and I'm assuming there will be another volume that covers the next 25 years. Obviously, even within that 25 years, 3 years of Antioch-Putney that I was at seems like, in terms of time, of really little consequence, because now we have a 50-year history, and you know, 3 years within that 50, you know, what did it really mean? On the other hand, one has to ask, without Antioch-Putney, would AUNE exist today? And one could say, but it does exist today, and as I observe the programs that are offered here and read a number of course descriptions and course content, obviously AUNE exists, and it exists carrying on that tradition that was started with the Putney School and Antioch-Putney. But still, to address the question, would it exist? I think probably not in the same form that it is today, because it just took those connections for it to happen. So what I would like to do today is address, first I'll deal with how I came to Antioch, and then quickly go over that first year that Todd and I spent, along with Roy, part of the year, at Putney, and then I would like to focus on what developed as the urban internships, because in Heidi's great book, she said that she did not have the chance to interview a whole number of other people, and I was one of those people that she did not get to interview, along with Dave Donald, who was named director of the Washington, D.C. Baltimore Center after I left Antioch. I was very excited when I saw the advertisement for the position at Antioch-Putney, and of course I was more excited when I was selected to be that faculty member after going through the interviews. And at that point in life, I thought myself as an emerging liberal, an educational progressive in terms of philosophy of education, and also the way I had run my public school classroom. My doctoral studies have really provided me with an opportunity, at least in the literature, to look at progressive educators such as Mann, Dewey, Rommel, of course, George Counts, and of course we couldn't leave out A.S. Neal. And unfortunately for me at that point, it was developing and my exposure had been in the literature. So I'd also been intrigued by my knowledge of Antioch's undergraduate education program with the work study aspect, as well as the fact that they were noted for their engagement in social issues and issues of justice. They had just had an episode in Yellow Springs with trying to integrate the barbershops in Yellow Springs, and that was not a very peaceful time, to say the least. Also, I was impressed with the strain of pacifism that I found within the community of Yellow Springs. And to that point in my life, my only exposure to pacifism had been through literature. But within the Yellow Springs community, you found person after person who had spent time in jail and alternate service, but more often in jail as a result of opposition to World War I, and particularly World War II. And also finding pacifists who carried it to the ultimate. To that point, I said, well, but you have to defend yourself. But I came across pacifists that, no, you do not defend yourself. You take modes to protect yourself, but that was it. Anyway, we go on from there. The first quarter at Antioch, the program was designed for four quarters at that time, with the idea that the first quarter would be in Yellow Springs, and then the three quarters at Putney. The design was for the first summer, for the first quarter to be summer, and then the three semesters at Putney. Unfortunately, we were late getting students recruited and registered for the program, and it soon became apparent that we would have students go to Yellow Springs for the first semester, first quarter, and work with Roy Fairfield and the faculty at Yellow Springs, and Todd and I would go off to Vermont and prepare the building for the arrival of students in January. So Todd and I spent the fall painting, putting in water lines, and wondering, because we weren't real craftspeople at that point, we were amateurs, what is this about? What were we really hired in for? Although I must admit, Todd and I had many, I think, wonderful dialogues and discussions about what education was supposed to be. The second and third quarter then at Putney, second quarter consisted of heavy field work, but heavy field trips, which Todd did a superb job of organizing, and we went off in the Corvair van across the Vermont, New Hampshire, visiting private schools, ending up also in New York City, and we happened to be there when Malcolm X was murdered, and we were actually in a community setting near where the funeral home was that Malcolm X was going to be, and this provided a little bit of anxiety. I also lost a fair amount of clothing at the hotel we were staying in, so we changed where we were going to stay for the rest of that. But it also, we spent time with the United Nations, and Todd had arranged a meeting with the representatives from Cuba, and at that time that was considered quite radical. We moved quickly to the third quarter, which mainly was the student teaching placements, and students continued with seminars. And I must say that that quarter seemed to be a relatively quiet quarter, though already we started to pick up the tension between traditional education, traditional graduate studies, and experiential education, or what we call really learner-centered education. So and during that third quarter, we realized that our students had been placed in small schools and suburban schools in Vermont, mostly, and private schools, and it dawned upon the faculty that we really weren't addressing the issue of the needs of schools and poverty areas or urban areas. And this is where really I want to focus my attention. It also requires some changes in the programs. And we had discussions with the administration in Boston and Philadelphia to try to work out student teaching placements first. Those discussions did not come to any real fruitful results. But then we had a discussion with Washington, D.C. administration, and from that we had the birth of the internships in the urban areas. This was made possible because of grants that we have received for experienced and inexperienced teacher fellowships. But very quickly we realized that we would have to alter the program because the internships were paid internships. We were able to pay them, as I said, from grants, but also by taking an X number of full-time faculty positions and then dividing the interns among them. So the interns actually ended up teaching three-quarters time during that year, with hopefully that other quarter of time being able to address social science coursework and also with seminars. Okay, time is going fast, so. The model really, we had hoped to have the interns work half-time first semester so that they could sort of adjust to that urban environment. But for strategic reasons, we had to go half the people work full-time one semester and then change into half-time the next. Throughout that whole urban experience, and I guess I'll just have to wait for questions and answers to talk about individual stories. The tensions for the interns became very apparent. Also, the issues of cultural shock of people going into the inner city, myself included. I had come from a farm background and had not had a real lot of exposure to certainly large urban areas other than Battle Creek, Michigan, and that just didn't match DC at all. But there was a real excitement about being in Washington, D.C. After all, it was an MAT program in the social sciences. Where better to be than in the nation's capital, where we had access to the political process, we had access to the national offices of professional organizations, also both the AFT, the NEA, and we utilized all of those resources for our seminars. Those first 2 years that I was in D.C., the first year we sort of operated out of my apartment, which was a studio apartment, utilizing, of course, community centers and agencies for places to hold seminars. We did have offices in the public schools, but come 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we really didn't have access to those. I can say that, the other thing I would like to say is that let me try to pick up. We were able to extend the center also to Philadelphia because we had a change of administration in Philadelphia, and they obviously were much more receptive to us. And in the second year that I was in D.C., we extended to Philadelphia, and there we were attempting to create another center similar to Washington, D.C. And the rest of this sort of becomes history that Dave Garland could certainly address. And one other important factor is that we were able to take over, work with the D.C. school system, and the D.C. school system agreed that Antioch-Putney would manage one of the schools in Adams Morgan. It was the Morgan School. Paul Lauder was hired in to carry out that project, and I had announced that my intention to leave Antioch-Putney. We hired David Darling, who had been executive director of National Council for Social Studies, and he took over the operation of that school, of that center. It changed greatly after I left, and I would just like to say that, there are many other things I'd like to say, but Antioch, my experience in Antioch was really one of a paid internship, and it was very important in what I became as a professional educator. And in leaving a number of things, other things out, I would like to just say we are where we are today, and I would like to say You know, when I look back on the history of it and I look at the DC school systems, the Philadelphia systems, other urban areas, you know, it looks the same as it did 50 years ago, because our society just has not addressed the real issues that are necessary to address to make a real difference in the lives of children who are caught in poverty and in the large, intense lives found in the urban schools. And that I can talk to on and on in terms of both my life, but with the experience of other interns. So I'd just like to say at this point, move forward, Antioch University New England, and keep the torch burning, and into the best of intellect, reason, and humanity prevails. Hopefully, my eternal fragments or essence will enable me to observe the 100th anniversary with many stories of success and fulfilling the hopes of the Putney Graduate School and the Antioch-Putney Graduate School and AUNE. Thank you.
Assignment of this committee, it brought to mind the quote from Timothy Leary. If you remember the 60s, you weren't there. Which says a lot about the drug culture of the 60s. And I thought it would be appropriate to note that although in my time at Antioch-Putney, in Putney, and I spent one semester in Washington, drugs, although available, were not a significant defining element of the culture whatsoever. So during the time that I was at Antioch-Putney, that is from the fall of 1967 to 1969, to the summer of 1969, people of my age had trouble with technology. Here are some events that took place. October 1967, March on the Pentagon. That was interesting because, shockingly, I would say 3/4 of the resident students at Putney Graduate School went on that march. And to my recollection, at least half of those that were there were arrested. So it became a badge of honor to have been arrested for some social activist involvement. In association with that, I believe it was almost a year later, Norm Wilson led the first march, the first anti-war march in Vermont, which went from Putney to Brattleboro. And I think there were you there, Charlene? Did you go ahead?
I think that was before.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
I recall it vividly. Norm was a tall man. Must have been about 6'4", and I was the very back of that line of 80 to 100 people, 40 of which were students from the Putney School. Looking ahead and watching him lead this group, and having the feeling that come over me that I have found the person that I will follow for the rest of my life. This is the man whose spirit and whose values I will emulate. That stayed with me, that memory, that feeling stayed with me for all of these 50 years. Well, not quite 50 years. On April 4th, in 68, Martin Luther King was assassinated. I had the occasion to hear Martin Luther King speak live in Washington while I was there at doing student teaching. And in the summers between 1966 and 69, I worked in the South training VISTA volunteers, primarily in African-American neighborhoods. So I had a profound sense of what racism meant in the South and what the civil rights movement was all about. And through that experience, had become deeply involved in trying to effect positive change in that regard. A few months later, Robert Kennedy was assassinated. In August 69, the Woodstock Festival happened. And in October 69, the moratorium to end the war in Vietnam. In other words, the time that I was at Antioch-Putney was a time of the culmination of the anti-war movement and the civil rights movement. And the degree to which that influenced that the Antioch-Putney experience, I would say, was profound. That's not because it was formally structured into the curriculum, although, of course, the curriculum, the educational experience, was completely sympathetic to and interested in that work. But it was the environment around Antioch-Putney that turned out to be, in some senses, profound. So let me touch a little bit on that environment, which was, I think, a unique environment, and you'll see why in a minute. Let's call it the whole hippie movement, back to the land movement, was coming of age at that very moment. And it took specific form in southeastern Vermont in a few communes. One named Packers Corners, which still exists in Guilford, Vermont, was formed by a group of people who had split from Liberation News Service. Liberation News Service was a leftist news service based in Washington. And the split that happened, I believe, occurred over the fact that there was a tension between the black participants in Liberation News Service and the African-American entities with which LNS was involved, including the Black Panther movement. And at some point, conversation, to summarize it and therefore do it complete injustice, was about LNS saying to the Black Panthers, how can we help you? And Black Panthers saying, gas guns. And that created a conflict within LNS that meant that some people couldn't deal with that issue. And they left and landed in Guilford, Vermont. Well, the fact that people who had been so active on the front lines of the anti-war movement and the pro-civil rights movement were settling in Vermont changed the culture. In Putney, the commune was named Red Clover. The two really prominent people at Red Clover were Carl Oglesby. Carl Oglesby is a historian, probably the preeminent academic of the New Left, and a remarkable speaker. He was the president of SDS, Students for Democratic Society. In other words, a leading activist in the whole anti-war movement. He was in Putney at the time, for a portion of the time that I was at Antioch-Putney. I remember vividly three nights at Red Clover hearing him talk as some of the most profoundly moving and well thought out arguments from a left point of view that I'd ever experienced. And Robert Kramer, who was the driving force behind Newsreel, which was the left media engine of the time. Newsreel covered a whole breadth of social issues, including getting footage from North Vietnam during the war and getting that footage distributed in the United States. And Kramer, for those 3 years that he was, in fact, the center of the most dynamic filmmaker at Newsreel, was spending a good portion of his time editing at Red Clover in Vermont. And one talked to him, one saw his work, and was, again, profoundly influenced by it. There were other communes, Montague, I don't know if you remember Charlene, the Montague commune. And movements like the Vince Ramos Brigade. I remember at least two people from Antioch-Putney went to Cuba on the Vince Ramos Brigade, which where you went and spent a few months harvesting sugar cane. I remember Eva and Leslie coming back from that and bringing a couple friends with them and sitting up in the main room late at night having an argument about one of those people saying, our mission must be to destroy the American agri-industry because it is corrupting the world and harming laborers in Cuba. And we have to do that without sparing any expense. We must destroy it. And I'm saying to myself, but if we destroy that, thousands and millions of people around the world are going to die, and that doesn't make sense to me. So there was this ongoing political dynamic at Antioch-Putney, which was informed by all of these other forces that were in the neighborhood. I want to say a few words about a couple of people. Francis Flaherty, the Flaherty Film Center. The widow of Robert Flaherty, the father of documentary filmmaker, the man who made Men of Moana, Louisiana Story. The Flaherty experience at that time, going to the Flaherty home, which was a study center, befriending Francis Flaherty, and getting the Flaherty perspective, non-preconception, as a part of how you thought about capturing human experience was, I think, profoundly important to Antioch-Putney. David Moe, a physicist who came to Wyndham College as a professor on the condition that he could teach anything he wanted. Not physics, by the way. and he was so immensely frugal and modest and lived in a little house. And I remember him talking about, well, I can get up at 6 a.m. and I have a light bulb under my desk. And if I turn it on and put my knees up close to it, I can get warm. But David created a program that Charlene and I were both fortunate to participate in, a fellowship program where we were able to teach at Wyndham College, and our friend Peter Werner participated in that program. David was a profound influence. Dorothea Stockwell, who taught Rogerian psychology, essentially, and the third force psychology movement, was profoundly influential when Charlene and some of our classmates started the School of Bowman Hill. Dorothea came and once a week and did group counseling and didn't charge us a penny, really remarkable. And later, one of our classmates, Jim Frazier, started a school at Paul and Dorothea's farm. What was the name of the school? I can't remember. Anyway, it was very much like the school that we started, that kind of hippie kind of culture dropout farm. Everything that you mentioned about what went on early, like trips to Mexico and building things, everything, we did that. I'm not going to comment on whether we were emulating John Humphrey Noyce. Jerry Gamble, I think one of the profoundly most important presence at Antioch-Putney in those years, known by his Mohawk name, Rorahokwats, started the Akwesasne Notes, which was really the first Native American political activist newspaper. It still exists today, but everyone at Antioch-Putney spent time pasting up Akwesasne Notes or writing articles for Akwesasne Notes, all under Jerry's direction. He brought with him always at least 2 and sometimes 8 or 9 Mohawk Indians who moved into the house. So Jerry's influence was staggeringly important. I attribute Corey Mudd, who became one of the most important documentary filmmakers about Native American Indians, to the influence of Jerry Gamble. Cora Bardwell, who was our cook, and became, after her time at Antioch-Putney, probably the greatest storyteller in Vermont. Her photograph is on the cover of a publication at the Vermont Folklife Center, and there's an audio of her storytelling. I could tell you so many wonderful stories about Cora. It's amazing. She gave a life to the building, the life of a warmth that the best possible grandmother in the world can create for you. There are many others. I just want to reference again the international aspect. In my first year at Antioch-Putney, Lee Min Sung was a Vietnamese student who lived in the building with us and wrote, I think it was a bi-weekly newsletter about the events at Antioch-Putney. I have not been able to find out whether any copies of that still exist. And then the next year, a Nigerian student named Olu Makindi was in residence at Antioch-Putney and was a remarkable person. All of that led to Full Shell Leading, Ken Pick and Virginia Scholl, Peter Werner, and myself, and some others, to start an idealistic alternative dropout high school at Bowman Hill in 1969. The story of which I will spare you, except to say that it was a wild ride. Thank you very much.
In the Putney Graduate School, Morris Mitchell, the desegregated community in the middle of Georgia. A friend of mine who went to the Putney Graduate School in New Sheldon, Ann Fines, tells about taking trips to the South where, because there was a black student at the Putney Graduate School, whenever they went through certain places in the South, they had to, the white people, they had to hide the black person in the bus so they would have been attacked. Those living in the middle of that kind of a time and living in the awareness of it is what seems so exciting to me now. Because we also have these injustices everywhere still, and there seems to be so little awareness of it. So sort of apathy or deadness, or perhaps it's too much for us. Anyway, that's not my talk. I just have a response to that. And I also just love this accounting of names and times and people that I knew and have forgotten about sometimes and not come back again. So thank you all. I got this list of instructions. I got a set of assignments about what I'm supposed to talk about today. And I'm going to do that. But I've also got a whole series of emails, maybe more emails than there are people in this room, about this weekend and about plans and suggestions and things like that. And one very helpful one, which arrived just a few days ago, was the dress code. That's interesting. The dress code is business social, and I was actually very glad to get that because I couldn't figure out what to wear. And I had been thinking about this. And since I had only two dress-up costumes, the way they used that word in the 19th century, and one I wore at the Horace Mann dinner, and the other one I wore when we launched the book in 1999. So, and then I thought, well, maybe what I should wear is what I wore then. So then I thought about, I had two costumes at Antioch-Putney. One was the one I wore when I was supervising student teachers, which was a beautiful wool dress from Carol Brown, who was the person who started that Forever Co-op. And it came up to, with stockings and little heels, because otherwise you practically couldn't go into a public school, and certainly not in official capacity. And I had already been fired in Putney, and one of the reasons I was fired was because I wore sandals to school. So I was quite careful about that. On the other hand, when I was a professor, well, you have to remember that
that in those days we did our own maintenance on the cars. And so we wanted to change the oil. We sort of lay down on the gravel in the driveway and unscrewed the little oil thing and got the oil out. And you sit up and you put it all back together, and then you wipe your hands on your jeans and learn to be a professor. I thought, well, I don't think either one of those is going to work. And anyway, the bulges would probably be in a different place. So thank you for telling me what business social. Only I don't know what business social is. And I also think that the business model in general has many inherent dangers. I think applying the business model to education is sort of like applying what you learn from rats in a laboratory to human behavior in general. That the business model is concerned about the bottom line. And the kind of education we were trying to figure out was concerned about human beings and how they live and how they can get to be better than they are and what we can do about that. Anyway, that was sort of a digression. So now I'm going to tell you, how did you find Antioch-Putney Graduate School and why did it appeal to you? Well, actually, I didn't find it. It found me. I was living in Putney. I had small children. And I had just been fired from the Putney Central School for being a communist. And a communist was a person who went on anti-war marches and wrote letters to the paper and wore sandals to school and didn't use textbooks. So, what better criteria for being hired for Antioch-Putney? I couldn't have done better by track. And then on top of that, there was a little group in town that wanted to start a small private school, and they asked me to come and give them some ideas. And Norman Wilson went to that talk. So after that, he asked me if I'd like to be one of the three faculty members, himself and Bob Winterhoff. And I wasn't going anywhere. It seemed like a really good idea. I didn't realize that it wasn't my education. It wasn't their education that was starting as much as it was mine. To be embedded in that community where so much was happening so fast, as you have described. But all of it was such, it was messy and it was stupid sometimes, but the idealism was so wonderful, and the energy behind that idealism. So I just fell into that. and then it says here, describe the students who came. How were they recruited? They were mostly recruited by the US government. If you were in education, then you could get a draft exemption. But it was also the times. Because there were people there who were doing something else other than going to Vietnam. But there were also people there who saw schools as one of the places where you could start making social change. And there were people who were already self-selected. And went into almost all of our first students were returnees from the Peace Corps or from some kinds of domestic Peace Corps type programs. And they were very fired up, as David describes. You should know, this is a secret that should not be published, is that those two people who went to Cuba but on the Vince Ramos Brigade did so with their work study money. I always love the way in which democratic institutions undermine their worst parts. Gandhi, for instance, was well educated in the British University. and the government paid for us to help out in Cuba. So we do, sometimes the government does things that it didn't intend to do for its own good in the long run. How did your experience at Antioch affect your career and your life? Well, Antioch was my life and my career. But I also had a life that became sort of interwoven. So there's no way really for me to separate out Antioch from, and what I was doing at Antioch from the rest of my life. Well, I had children. What I learned in my children, I told the people who were teaching in the elementary school. What I learned from the people at Antioch whom I watched teaching, I applied to my family life. Books I assigned became significant influences in my own life. And probably other influences in my life affected what I did at school, probably those students. So it's, I once had a, early in my teaching days at Antioch, I had a student whom I was watching in the classroom, and I thought one of the reasons this is working for him and it's working so well is because that's who he is. If you were to slice him, he'd be the same all the way through. And it is when you have both the skills of teaching and the ability to have compassion, to care, to listen and to respond, when you have those things, you don't have them just at work and you don't have them just at home. You have them wherever you are. And that kind of integrity, that sort of, I know where I stand and I'm not going to wobble, is one of the things I think that characterized the faculty and the students and a lot of the people that we worked with. It's hard to describe how blessed you are to be able to live in an environment and work in an environment which has this kind of consistency. I don't want to stop. Oh, good. I'm almost ready to stop. I didn't want to stop without saying something about David Sobel, who really should be a link in this. Just as Todd was a link between the Putney Graduate School and Antioch-Putney, David is the link between Antioch-Putney and Antioch New England and Antioch University New England. All those changes. He came as a student to Antioch-Putney and spent most of his time with a subsidiary program we had with the Prospect Center in Bennington. One of the great things about the graduate school in its early days was there was such flexibility. So you could send four students off to Bennington and call them back just the way you call back your students from Yellow Springs. They'd hardly ever seen your building, but they had seen the whole ethos, the spirit of it. So David was there. He went from Antioch-Putney to Harrisville, and from Harrisville to Elm Street, and from Elm Street to Roxbury Street. Now he's here. So that's 50 years. Almost, probably shy in the 2 or 3 at the beginning. And in that time, has also moved from being director of a little program in elementary education to being the idea person behind the education department at Antioch, New England. And now, off there somewhere in the woods doing things with kids in the forest. So I want to be sure I get that kind of recorded as an important piece of Antioch-Putney's history. So I have to say it again. It's been a great ride.
Co-chairs of higher education departments with Heidi Watts, David Sobel, and David Murray. So I was running the Putney Co-op. In fact, when you came in to the Putney Co-op, it was in the Putney Co-op that you said to me, the chairmanship of the Wyndham College Education Department is open. Do you want to apply jointly and we'd share the job half time? You could do secondary education, I'd do elementary. So I said, sure, I'd like to teach some more. So we applied, and lo and behold, I mean, I don't know how we did it, we got the job. nobody else wanted it, I guess. So shortly after we started, I had gone to a meeting at the Brattleboro Union High School of the Social Studies Department. And I was there in order to represent Wyndham College and its interest in placing student teachers at Brattleboro High School. I came back from the meeting, and when I saw Heidi, I said, I've just gone to this meeting, and do you know what? There isn't one woman teacher in the whole social studies department at Brattleboro High School. Not one woman. And we went back and forth about that for a few minutes and then went on our merry way. The next, not one department had either. So the next day that I bumped into her, Heidi said, you know, I've really been thinking about what you observed in Brattleboro. And I suggest that I become chair of the education department at Wyndham College. So I became secondary.
Okay, this has been great. Thank you. Let's do another round of applause. That if any of you need to leave, we understand, but I'd like to go a few more minutes so that we give you a chance to ask questions and also to share some of your stories here. So if that's okay with the scheduling of this room.
I think probably 10, 15 minutes.
Great, almost. 10 or 15 minutes, let's see. So how about some burning questions for the panelists? Yes.
Or how about some good stories?
Or a story, right.
Well, I guess my story is similar to many in this room. Antioch impacted my life. I was getting ready to graduate from Olivet College, and I walked out of the cafeteria, and there was Fran. Little did I know at that point that my life was beginning to take a real turn, because soon after, I found myself on a street corner in Washington, D.C., being assigned to teach at a school. So all of that being said, I also ended up in summer down in the Mississippi, doing some voter registration work, and that was, needless to say, quite an intimidating process. And upon graduation from Antioch, I was very much influenced by many of the students who were former Peace Corps volunteers. So, of course, then I went into the Peace Corps, and subsequent to that, I launched on basically right now, if you sit here today, a 44-year social activist. A professional career, civil rights worker, advocate for senior issues, and so on and so forth. So Antioch, frankly, turned my head and turned my corner in terms of my life.
Thank you. More questions or stories? The person who just spoke was Tom Apple, and if you receive the mic, please introduce yourself so that we know who's speaking.
Hi, my name is Libby Barber Charlton, and Antioch was an amazing experience for me. I was not your typical Antioch-Putney student. I had just come out of Middlebury College, and thanks to Roy and Norm, I ended up being in the program and having what I call my most transformative year. I was assigned to first we went to Yellow Springs, and that was, Antioch at that time was very, very liberal compared to Middlebury, so it was quite a shock to be there. We did canvassing about Vietnam in Dayton, which I didn't realize, I guess, at the time that was a very military type town. And then in September, or the end of August, we went back to Washington, D.C., and I was assigned to a junior high school called Randall Junior High School, which had 1,100 black students and 10 white people. And that year, going to courses, meeting all the people in my program, most of whom had been in the Peace Corps, was just amazing. And it was a year of survival, but also a year, as you were saying, about you know, all the events. It was 67, 68. And so all the events were happening right around us. There were tanks on the street after Martin Luther King was assassinated. My students were looting. It was just an amazing year, and I can't believe how hard we worked. Work was the key. We worked, you know, taking courses. We worked almost teaching full time. And I had the sad situation where I covered a class, like there were five classes that two interns covered. One did three, one did two classes. And the woman who I taught with, her husband and only child were killed in an automobile accident in October. So I have to cover even more. And thanks to very supportive people there, I made it through the whole year. And then, of course, the summer in Putney, and there was a group of us living in Canoe Brook. I don't know if the other people remember that, but it was a building down on Route 5, a farm kind of thing, and the rest of the people stayed up in Maple Glen. And I brought you an artifact. In order to graduate from the program, you had to keep a journal for the whole year. And I have this wonderful journal annotated by Norm Wilson. And it has everything. It has, it looks like this. It's all handwritten. Of course, we didn't have, you know, any other way to write. So it's just page after page of everything and, you know, all the wonderful experiences. And at the end of that year, the Peace Corps came in for me because I was going to go on the first trip to Swaziland. But I managed through another person in the program to meet a young man who had just come back from the Peace Corps in Sierra Leone. And I ended up marrying him. And then we settled in Northern Massachusetts later on. And we both taught for 20 years. Well, he taught for 35 years, and I probably taught for 25 years. And we now run a farm. And so if you ever drive down to Boston from here, you come right by our farm. It's on Route 140 in Winchendon. It's fun for me now because all the time there are like environmental students who come by from this program, and I know, I look at them and I say, are you from Antioch? Because they look so Antiochian to me. And they say, oh yes, we're from Antioch.
Jack Calvin, and I work here, and I'm just struck as I listen to your stories that the substrate for what we still do here was laid really back in the 40s, if you go with in the 30s perhaps even, but those of you who spoke, those threads were laid down, and the cloth looks a little different now, and Heidi's concerns about training rats versus people, notwithstanding, the place still embraces much of what you have shared with us. So I'm just struck by that.
Thank you, Jack. Sheldon.
I'm Sheldon Weeks. I just want to speak for those from the 1950s. I was actually at Putney, 59 to 60, but most of the time was spent in Europe. From December on, the group went to Europe, including study tours in Sweden, which Morris, I'm sure, took others to, his middle way, that he loved so much, but also to the Soviet Union and Poland, where we had amazing experiences. I first met Morris after graduating from Swarthmore. I spent 5 years working for the American Friends Service Committee as youth secretary in New York City. And somehow, I think through Macedonia first, which did continue later, was eventually taken over a community plaything of Bruderhof, but Morris found in the programs we were running something he could bring students from the Putney Graduate School to New York City. We had weekend work camps dealing with the rats in homes. We had UN seminars. We had institutional service units in the mental hospital on Ward's Island, and a week-long program on urban social change. So different groups came from Putney to these. And this, a lot of our friends involved with the service committee were students at Putney in the 50s. And our link to Antioch is really not only in all that spirit of what people were doing, the students and staff at Putney, but that our degree is now from Antioch. Thank you.
Okay, any more burning questions, stories? Yes, this will be the last one and then we'll bring closure.
I'm so sorry for coming in late, but I am guessing somebody has already shared this, but I'm an alum from 2003, and my name is Jamie Comtois, and part of the reason I was late is because we're co-hosting the Monadnock International Film Festival the same time as this weekend. And I just wanted to say that many of us alums from more recent years have continued with your legacy by doing transformative social change work in the arts, in through food movements, and who are doing a lot of work around workers' rights and really being transformative. And so I'm so excited to just thank you for the work you have done and the groundwork you have laid, because generations from then have continued that work, and we continue in this very moment in very real ways, both in this region, but also around the country and the world. So thank you.
And I'm gonna take just a minute to thank Jamie and Cindy and Julie, and I'm pointing, and Judy, the members of the 50th Anniversary Planning Committee. Jack, let's see, stand please, those of you, so that I know that I got, and Jennifer. Have I missed anyone else in the room? Let me also make sure that I cover Heather Atwell, whom you're gonna see around here, Ed Carrigan, who's a member of the board, Emily Haig, Linda Rubenstein, Roland Russell, also were members of this planning committee and have worked tirelessly. I also want to thank the students, the staff, the faculty here in this community have made this weekend of activities happen. It is really because of their coming together in yet one more time in a very community way to make it happen. And I would like to spend just a few minutes here making sure that you are reminded, those of you who haven't recently updated your information or you know someone, an alum, one of the challenges this week for planning all of this is that we didn't have a complete database of alums. So if you know alums that may not be in touch with us, or you have updated information, also, I want to invite all of you to the social this evening at Glen Maples in Putney. There's driving instructions in case some of you who may think you know the way but are not quite sure, or have never been there before, there are driving instructions on the table out here, and so you're invited to that. That is the original home of the Putney Graduate School. And I would not be doing my duty as a board member without inviting you to pick up a donation envelope and use it if you possibly can. We welcome donations, as has been alluded to by our panelists and by our president. Antioch is always on a very tight budget, and we also are putting as much money as we can into scholarships to assist our students in their expensive efforts. One last quick thing, we've compiled a timeline and we've printed it in multiple copies. It's out here on the table, it's a timeline of the institution, and we hope that it will be a stimulant to more facts and more stories from you to that you can add. There'll be times to record those stories. Before we absolutely end, I want to thank our panelists again. Thank them for agreeing to talk with us. Thank them for their investment of time and money to come here, and also for their observations and their assistance in from Todd helping us form a very strong historic base of how what was happening in the New England context itself that might have given rise, in fact, that did give rise to the Putney School and the Putney Graduate School. To Fran, who broadened our geography, to the Yellow Springs environment and what was happening there that was made it such a natural partnership for the Putney Graduate School, and then taking our thoughts into the urban cities of the 60s and what was happening that was in such desperate need of attention. David, who also expanded our thinking about the New England context, particularly Putney and the dynamic people who began their careers or in fact were in the midst of their careers making change. I mean, how many, for example, film documentarians did he mention? And what an important movement that visual art is in every aspect of our lives now. And then Heidi, who so creatively illustrated for us what are the continuing trends and culture values throughout our 50-year history, and some of the ways we've changed in the modern context as well. So thank you all very, very much, and another round of applause.
In here today because it would be a total mistake if we didn't take a moment to acknowledge Pat Wand and all her energy and vision in not only putting this panel together but also putting the social together this afternoon. Again, everyone is invited to that. Pat has served as the chair of our 50th anniversary committee, and we created a lot with very little out of nothing. And it's going to be a wonderful set of memories that I hope all of you are able to take home. So, Pat, thank you. One more thing. Steve and Pat and David have all mentioned Heidi's book, and we do have copies of Heidi's book at the table, and there's some additional copies. We kind of would like to ask for a small donation if you'd like to have a copy of that, but please feel free to know that we have plenty of copies if you are interested. Anything else?
I think this is it. Enjoy the weekend schedules, attend anything you